Hello, coffee drinkers. It is time for some Q&A. Haven't done one of these in a few days, maybe even more than a week or so. So I figured there are a bunch of questions stacking up on the vlog below in the comments on these videos. Let's get to a Q&A for today's vlog. First question comes from Jeff Bauk, I want to say that is, who asks, from a jazz perspective, is it still essential to have standards memorized and to focus heavily on the old rep? Aside from playing them at jams like Smalls and playing one-off gigs with musicians you don't regularly play with, are standards still standard? Why do you feel the list of standards isn't being updated to incorporate what modern jazzers are actually playing? I'm currently in an academic setting where your worth as a musician seems to be only as high as the number of standards you have memorized. However, Jojo and John seem to be saying that Train would be upset to find people still playing standards and that jazz is only being played when the music is progressive and pushing forward. Wow, this is a long question. Obviously, I realize the need to study them in terms of learning the language and having context for modern music, so I'm not saying one should never learn standards, but is it culturally relevant to have 80 to 100 tunes memorized? Wow, that is an epically long question. To sum it up, yeah, I think you were onto something by referencing Jojo Mayer and John Davis. You know, where Train, maybe he would be upset if he was still around and people were still playing standards. I don't know. Look, it's all about perspective. Yeah, I totally get it. If you're in school and, you know, it's like the old cutting sessions and who knows more standards and who knows the obscure standards, that's a thing. That's kind of a metric by which people judge others' abilities. I think that's a crock of shit, basically, because you should be playing what you want to play. You touched on it a little bit in the, yeah, it can be useful as a reference and to understand the framework of a certain period of the history of music and of some improvised music, some jazz music. Yes, absolutely. I played them a ton. I was in the same situation as you when I was at Berkeley. I did play a lot of standards. There was definitely some pressure and some, you know, some basic requirement. If you wanted to play with the hip cats and you wanted to play with the best players, it was really useful to know a bunch of tunes just so you could be included in that kind of circle. So I don't think it was really an attitude thing or an image thing, or it wasn't really, you know, they weren't really judging me and I wasn't judging them on which standards they knew, but it was definitely useful in terms of being accepted into a certain circle of musicians at that time. Like I've said so many times with standards, probably the last time I played a jazz standard was with Mike Stern 2 years ago, because we generally play a tune or two on a gig with him. That was the last time I think we played a standard, or the last time I played a standard. So to me, it's not relevant. It's different for everyone. Some people, all they do is play standards. That's their repertoire. There are some singers, some guitar players, some band leaders even, who that's their entire thing. So it's all about context. Yes, it's a useful learning tool. Yes, I have played them in the past. Yes, I've probably forgotten most of them. But it was also a great ear training thing, and being able to hear the motion of two fives and, you know, work your way through forms and retain forms. I didn't just use learning jazz standards to learn jazz standards. It was so much more than that. It was about just the process of learning repertoire, regardless of what the content was, and understanding how to keep a form and how to feel a form and the differences in form, like AABA or ABA or AB or 16-bar forms, 32-bar forms. Really useful for those kind of things. So keep an open mind if you are learning them and working with them, and understand that it can really be way more about just the jazz element of it. It can be so much more in terms of learning, and really it's all about context and it's all about what you want to do. Don't let anyone push you around and tell you what you have to do when it comes to jazz standards. Scalahan asks, hi, what is the drone that you use for the aerial footage? It's very nice. Yes, it is very nice indeed. You left that comment on a recent video, so I'm guessing that the most recent aerial footage you've seen is the DJI Mavic Pro. It's this thing right here, drone, controller, pretty small. The reason I got the Mavic Pro was because it fits in my backpack for when I was traveling. I have the DJI Phantom 4 also, which I've used in the vlog sometimes, especially when I'm home, because it is a slightly better tool in terms of the picture quality. It just takes up a lot more space when I'm traveling. So it's either the DJI Phantom 4, which will be in some older vlogs, or more recently it's been the DJI Mavic Pro. Stuart Francis writes, isn't 7 days in 5/8? Good stuff though. Yeah, you know what? It's and there were various replies to that, which bolster Stuart's thing of it being 5/8, and then kind of really get to the crux of what I was talking about, which was just the concept of playing in five, whether it was 5/4 or 5/8. I actually hear it in 5/4. I hear 1, 2, 3, 4, bombed. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3. I hear that as the four and the subdivision da 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 as the eighth note, rather than 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 being the eighth note and da 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 the hi-hat part being 16th notes. It's just how I hear it. I'm pretty sure that will never have been written out for Vinnie Colaiuta to play. I'm pretty sure Sting would never have given him a chart or haven't written it down at all. I'm just, you know, guessing here, but I'm pretty sure that will have been something that they just came up with in the studio, and it probably wasn't even discussed as to whether it was 5/4, 5/8. The 4 and the 8, not really important in terms of what I was trying to talk about in the video for learning odd meters. It was really about the overall concept of having that clave, which works whether it's in 5, whether you're hearing it and feeling it in 8 or 4. Ewan Plump asks, does Chelsea have a bass vlog? She does not. But we have talked about it, and I think the general consensus with me and her and everyone who's mentioned something like that online is that it would be very, very cool. I think she would have a lot of insight into so many different things, and I don't know, maybe when we get a place together, we'll set up like a little video studio for her. I don't know, or not even, maybe even before then, and see if we can like get her fired up on a YouTube channel and talking to you guys. I think it would be very, very cool. Alon Penner Tesla chimes in and says, I was actually right about that Israeli 7/4 thing, and left a great link of a pop song that he played on, which is like the 3 and then 4 for 7. So awesome. I'm glad I remembered that. Thank you very much for confirming that. Awesome job on the tune. PS51 Noah writes, actually a long comment about the vlog. Thank you very much for the very nice words. And the question is, I really want to work more on the fundamentals and really get that under my fingers and in my head so that when I play things will be better in a band context and more interesting overall. My question to you is, should I seek out an instructor to help me with those fundamentals, or do you think that I could study it in a book? Probably yes and no to both of those things, and then yes to a ton of other options as well. I think that if you find a book that you like, that can be really helpful in terms of giving you ideas for material. That's why I wrote all the good stuff. That's why I put all of these exercises in here, because those are the ones I use on a regular basis, and those are the ones that kind of help keep me motivated and populate my practice routine. This is by no means the be-all and end-all of music practice books. It just happens to be the one I wrote and the kind of the ideas that I use. And I also think it's good for all levels, no matter where you're at. But really, that kind of leads perfectly into the point of, it's all about what you want to get out of your music. And if you have a great relationship with an instructor who inspires you to be better and to practice more and to work harder, then yes, getting an instructor is absolutely the thing to do. If there's a book, any kind of book or learning material that inspires you to be better and to work harder, then that's the right thing to do. I would probably guess that it's a combination of a bunch of different things. It's a combination of asking yourself how much work you're willing to do and how much you're committed to it. So then that gives you a framework of, okay, I need to set this amount of time aside roughly. Then you want to ask yourself, okay, who do I like? You know, who do I like being around? Do you know any instructors? What music is inspiring to you? As soon as you answer all of those questions, it really kind of opens the door to the kind of the correct path or the right path for you that you need to walk down and follow. So I think probably it's a combination of all of the things you mentioned, plus some more stuff, plus just being completely immersed in great music and music you enjoy and music that is inspirational to you. Okay, one last question for today's vlog, because it's a long one and it's a very, very cool one. It's from Stephen Yates, who writes some very kind words. Loving your work, Janek. You are my morning coffee routine. Coffee and Janek. Awesome. Thank you, Stephen. Great that you're checking out the vlog. He says, I want to challenge you on the don't learn it, feel it thing. If we are to look at your success and progress in tennis, if your coach said, don't learn theory, don't waste time understanding and studying what has been documented about technique and game theory, just play and have fun, would that make sense? if you got on a plane and the pilot said, I never learned theory of flying, I just watched a load of pilots and then figured it out for myself, I've got my own style, does that make sense? I know flying and tennising and basing are different things, but don't you need to know the rules in order to break them? Otherwise, it's a long journey. Super deep question, can be answered a thousand different ways. I will try and put together my two cents for you right now. Yes, I think flying and tennising and basing, like you said, are very, very different things. I think that, you know, if we're talking about flying a commercial airliner, my knowledge of that is limited to virtually zero. I'm an airline passenger. I just understand the need for responsibility having the responsibility for passengers and as that being a job and not necessarily being an artistic endeavor. So you're not necessarily making so many emotional choices when you fly a commercial jetliner. You're really following a very rigid set of rules. And if you're breaking those rules as a commercial airline pilot, then you're probably going to have some massive issues in terms of your responsibility to the public and to your bosses and just legally speaking. So in that sense, I think they're so incredibly different that to me that is probably not a great comparison in terms of the learning process. With the tennis thing, I definitely think, and I know this from experience, that yes, my coach has planted some theory, and I don't really know if you call it theory. I mean, he's really helped my technique by me seeing him do it. And that's how I learned technique with the bass. I went out and watched Lawrence Cottle every night of the week. You know, I didn't have somebody telling me where to put my fingers. I didn't have somebody telling me that, oh, this mode goes with that chord, you know. And with my coach, yeah, he puts a little idea in my head, like, okay, perhaps you need a slightly bigger target so that you're not hitting, you know, if you're aiming for the center of a large target on the other side of the net, you're not aiming for this pinpoint when you don't have the fundamental technique to make that shot, which is a low percentage shot anyway. So the idea being stay away from the lines, have a bigger target, the ball will stay in. This is a very small idea, very kind of, it's like the embryonic stages of game theory and strategy. But it's really about doing it over and over again, repetition, 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 and learning by feel, learning by touch, and learning by being around someone who's a great player. My coach happens to be a world-class player, and being across the net from him teaches me a lot without him having to say very much. So for me, my experience, to answer your question, my experience with that has definitely been incredibly similar to the way I talk about learning music, which is by that immersion and not coming from a theoretical standpoint, but coming from an emotional standpoint. And you can't make great emotional choices right away when you first start doing something like music or like tennis. But my process and the process I've experienced with tennis has been very similar, my music and tennis process, in that it has been complete immersion. It really has been watching a lot of footage of tennis players, watching a lot of footage of my own playing, watching it back and seeing where the mistakes are and knowing exactly what I was feeling at that point and how I have to adjust that feeling and knowing what the feeling is for a positive outcome, having positive reinforcement from a coach when I start to do something right. He doesn't just put my hands in the right place and like, you know, okay, you have the theory, now you can just do it. Because you have to have repetition, you have to have immersion in order to make that a reality, I think. So I think that I really stand by my method and my concept when it comes to that, when it comes to the theoretical standpoint of learning something. The flying thing, holy cow, you know, I don't know. There are also pilots that are very artistic and stunt pilots and pilots who do break all the rules, and I just don't have any experience in that to be able to comment on it. With the tennis thing, I do. Very much. And I have made incredibly accelerated progress with my tennis game since I started almost 4 years ago. From nothing to what I do now is a very large improvement. It's nowhere near a professional, of course, but it's to the point where I can really play the game and get some enjoyment out of it and play matches and do have some, you know, concept of strategy and some concept of how to hit most shots. There are definitely weaknesses in my game that I need to work on, so I continually do. And it's about repetition, it's about immersion. And every time I'm around a great player, that improves what I'm doing. There's a kid who's like 14 at my club and plays with so much topspin that just sitting on the court and watching him play for 10 or 15 minutes before I went to my practice session changed the way I practiced that day, just being in the presence of that particular technique and being around it and think, oh yeah, the loose wrist and really letting the head of the racket go and taking the ball in front of you and not letting it come behind and really playing from low to high and all of those things really improved the way I played. And I played with so much spin that day that I went through two rackets in one session. You know, when you play with spin, you're going to pop strings. And that was really, that highlighted how important it is to be around great players, whether it be tennis players or musicians, in order to improve. I think that's a great tool to use. We can't always do it, of course. There's not always access to other really amazing musicians or amazing tennis players who are so much better than us. But it happens. And when it does happen, it's really, really cool to be a part of it and to also to be aware that that's what's happening. And when you see someone or something that is so much better from you, follow your curiosity towards it, pay attention, you know, soak that up. So I hope that answered your question. I hope that debated the kind of the two sides of it for you. And thanks for the awesome question. Thanks for sticking around. Everyone, thanks for sticking around and watching the vlog. It's awesome. We're day 188 today. I think day 200, that might be a bit of a landmark number in the vlog. I'm going to be on a plane with Chelsea going to Europe. We'll try and do something cool for number 200, but it's right around the corner. Vlog is awesome. You guys are awesome, but today's vlog is done. I will see you guys tomorrow.